Our next topic is community ecology. In this opening picture, we see two populations, the wood stork and the sawgrass. We can also imagine many other populations that likely exist in this community, including various species of fish, amphibians, and insects, as well as many species of plants and bacteria. Community ecologists would study how all of these populations interact. Another way of defining community ecology is to say that it is the study of how an ecosystem functions. Ecosystem function includes things like how the space is structured, why certain species thrive and others do not, how species interact, and how energy flows through food webs, and how the species contribute to ecosystem services. Ecosystem services, as the term implies, are all the services that an ecosystem is able to provide. Check out some examples of ecosystem services provided by different types of ecosystem, shown in this table. The Everglades provide many of these same ecosystem services, including water purification, nutrient cycling, flood control, groundwater recharge, pollination, etc. Unfortunately, many of these ecosystem services are not well understood and are not always included in economic analysis for development. And generally, if we were to put dollar values on these services, the values would be staggering. Interestingly, humans drained much of the Everglades in the 1900s, in part for flood control. Later, we realized that the Everglades were actually very effective flood control. So now, we're trying to restore the ecosystem and reverse the damage that we did. So how do wetlands control flooding? In general, wetlands, including the Everglades, capture and store rainfall and runoff, and then releases the water slowly, reducing peak flood levels and also recharging groundwater resources. And remember, it's not just the Everglades wetlands that provide these services. Locally, our coastal wetlands and our riparian zone wetlands also provide flood control. As climate change progresses and ocean levels rise, our coastal wetlands are increasingly important for flood control. And all the local communities around the bay could benefit from wetland restoration and protection. When I say benefit, I mean dollar values. These wetlands can protect us from expensive flooding. In addition to studying ecosystem services, community ecologists also study how humans impact ecological communities. Obviously, humans often have numerous and significant impacts on ecological communities. Consider the Everglades. First, consider canals. Channelizing water created deeper and faster water in some areas, and then vast dried-out regions in others. Whereas previously, this whole area was shallow, slow-moving water. The organisms that are adapted to the shallow, slow-moving water are unlikely to do well in the deep, fast-moving channels or the dried-out areas. Next, consider dams. Deep, non-moving water with low oxygen content. Nothing like this existed there previously. Further, the whole region was crisscrossed with roads. The roads cut off water routes, blocked migration patterns, separated some species from their food sources, and were a source of air pollution and noise. In addition to the air pollution, there's water pollution now as runoff from the roads gets into the natural ecosystems, and additionally there's excessive nutrients from local nearby agriculture. Another very important human impact is the intentional and non-intentional introduction of a wide variety of invasive species. We'll cover invasive species next week. And then finally, perhaps most profoundly, climate change. changing temperature and precipitation patterns is likely already having huge impacts on the Everglades ecosystem. So this is quite a list, and realistically, we could go into more detail on these six general impacts. Additionally, there's other impacts that we just haven't yet listed here. Not all species are equally vulnerable to human-induced and natural changes. The wood stork is an indicator species in the Everglades, meaning that it is a species very vulnerable to change. Now that this is understood, ecologists can monitor the wood stork population to try to keep tabs on the health of the whole ecosystem. So what's happened to the wood stork? I won't recount the whole wood stork story here. You should review your textbook for that. However, it is worth noting that in general, the wading bird population in the Everglades declined over 90% from the 1930s to the 1990s. That's huge. Part of this decline can be explained by looking at the Everglades food web. Historically, the wood stork relied on the gradual drying out of the Everglades. Each year, as the pools dried up, fish and amphibians would become more concentrated in smaller pools where the storks would hunt. Review your textbook to review the interesting strategy the wood stork has for hunting and how it relies on very dense concentrations of prey within the pools where it hunts. Starting in the 1930s, humans drained thousands of acres of wetlands in the Everglades, channeling water away to the east and west in large, fast-moving canals, which were unsuitable for the stork, and leaving thousands of acres of dry land, which was also unsuitable for the stork. Essentially, many of the organisms at the base of the food chain were impacted, sawgrass, algae, as well as most of the stork's food supply, fish, shrimp, and frogs. This forced the wood stork to fly farther and farther from its nesting grounds to feed. And it caused a dramatic decline in their population. As we noted, the wood stork was not the only species dramatically impacted by the draining of the Everglades. As noted, many of the producers were affected, such as the algae and the sawgrass, as were the fish and shrimps and frogs that are low on the food chain that relied on the algae and the sawgrass. As the base of a food chain diminishes, it becomes much harder for the higher trophic level organisms to survive. In addition to water quantity issues, there are also human-related water quality issues. Agriculture that was able to thrive in the drained wetland area released synthetic nutrients from fertilizers into these ecosystems. You may recall that phosphorus is often the limiting nutrient in lake and other wetland ecosystems. So this increase in nutrients created algae blooms, which have their own problems, but also it allowed the cattails to outcompete the sawgrass. Sawgrass was adept at living in low nutrient waters. Once the waters had more nutrients in them, cattails were able to outcompete the sawgrass for the same habitat. The original Everglades ecosystem had a high level of ecosystem complexity. The channelization of water flow and the subsequent drying out of much of the region decreased the structural complexity of this ecosystem. Where there had once been thousands of different pools of varied connectivity, depth, and velocity, now there was either dry land or deep, fast channels. Additionally, regions on the edges of ecosystems typically have a high level of species diversity because they have members of both communities plus those unique to the edge. The streamlining of water flow simplified the vegetative structure and also thus provided less edge effect, thus providing fewer potential ecological niches, and the result was less species richness in the ecosystem. Let's review those concepts again. So ecosystem complexity is what determines species richness. So the more variable and complex the ecosystem is, the higher number of potential niches are available, and so the more species you will likely have. Additionally, related to that, when you have edges present between different types of ecosystems, this is where you really get a lot of species richness. This region at the edge of two ecosystems is called the ecotone. And again, this is where you get a lot of species richness. So by draining the Everglades and creating basically only two distinct ecosystems, dry or channeled water, you dramatically decreased the complexity of vegetation, the complexity of the ecosystem, and also thus the species richness of the whole area. So why do we care about species richness? Well, basically, the greater species richness, the more resilient the ecological community, and the better able that community is to provide ecosystem services. So why is this? How does this work? Well, it has to do with the species' ecological niche, or the unique role it plays in the ecosystem. No two species can have exactly the same niche. That concept is called competitive exclusion. One species will exclude the other from a portion of that same niche due to competition for resources. So as an example, let's consider these two anole. The fundamental niche, the fundamental role that this green anole could play in the ecosystem overlaps with the brown anole. And the brown anole can outcompete the green anole for some aspect of that niche, whether it's where it hunts or what it eats or where it lives. So the realized niche of the green anole is smaller. But if the brown anole were to leave that ecosystem, the green anole could take over that part of the niche again. Indeed, when two species niches overlap, they often diverge in terms of the role they play in the ecosystem, right, to reduce the competition. We see this in many different ecosystems, from the warblers where they nest and hunt, to the Galapagos finches in terms of what they eat, etc. But now let's go back to the Everglades. We said that greater species richness means a more resilient community. If species richness is high, there are likely many species who are filling only a small part of their fundamental niche. In other words, they could play a larger role or a different role in the community, but their role is reduced to their realized niche due to competition and resource partitioning. Thus, when one species declines or is lost, there will likely be another species able to take its place. However, as species richness declines, the community may not be able to bounce back from the decline or loss of a particular species. And as a result, the ecosystem will not be able to deliver the same ecosystem services. One final topic in this clip. Your book went into some detail about the interactions among the different species in the Everglades ecosystem. You should have a good handle on symbiosis, predation, and competition, and be able to give good examples of each, as well as their definition. Additionally, for symbiotic relationships, remember that there's three different types of this intimate relationship. There's mutualism, where both species benefit. There's commensalism, where one benefits and the other is seemingly unaffected. And there's parasitism, where one species benefits and the other is adversely affected. So be sure you're able to define all of these terms and give good examples from the Everglades ecosystem, as well as examples from other ecosystems.